You are listening to a free version of Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support the show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Tuesday, January 3rd, 2017. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, our first of 2017. Hello, 2017. Goodbye, congressional ethics. Republicans claim mandate. And they already have a long list of what they're going to do. Today is the swearing-in day for the House, anyways. Obamacare repeal, a boon for black lung disease. And how will the press cover Trump's lies? Here's a hint. Probably not with that word. And corporations lining up to pretend they're saving jobs because of Donald Trump. Ford, the latest. We'll tell you why. And Obama leaves twice the number of judicial vacancies than he got when he came into office, with at least 25 of them stalled over the past year because the Senate, of course, wasn't just Merrick Garland. They just said, F it. We don't need to fill any of them. We do have some good news, folks. It's not great news yet, but it's good news. Israeli police question Bibi Netanyahu regarding a corruption allegation.
Can we add him to the Chris Christie, Rick Schneider, please, God, Jesus, go to jail list?
Well,
or
Chris Christie's probably saved because of Obama. I mean, of Trump.
Right, right, right.
And Colorado provides a wonderful example of our privatized future. All this and more. Your phone calls. Your IMs. And our harrowing stories of New Year's, I guess. The end of 2016. We are back from vacation. Yes, I have a little bit of a cold, and yes, did gain about 15 pounds.
I did.
All, it's hanging in the gut. I can see it from my angle.
It's honestly,
yeah, he's not lying.
It's fortunately because of my age now, it just sinks. So it's all basically like, it's almost impossible for me to get out of the chair.
You're a liar.
I'm not lying.
You might be overselling it a bit, but.
Maybe just a little bit, but I'm also working. I'm not done. I'm not.
It's just the beginning.
I'm not gonna stop just because.
Are you formally committed to getting like mid-age, like gut, keeping it?
I feel like I'm already there. So.
Well, you are, but you occasionally will say, like, hey, I need to go to the gym, or what kind of yoga should I do?
You have body dysmorphia.
I have not been to the gym in...
Oh, no. You certainly haven't, but occasionally you'll say, like,
Myla,
I got to do it.
You have body dysmorphia.
For Hanukkah, Myla gave me pro push-up things.
Really?
And a ab roller.
Yeah!
That's hilarious.
That's awesome.
Absolutely, yeah. Hysterical.
I love those.
That's all you need.
Yeah, that's all I need.
If you use them.
Yeah, well, yeah, right. If I use them.
Right.
So, folks, I hope you had a good break. We got a lot of very nice emails about the best ofs, particularly from some members. A lot of people really appreciated hearing the stuff on fascism from Lewis Lapham, and that, of course, was from over probably over to a decade ago. Matt was digging around, found that. And he was talking about the Umberto Eco piece on fascism.
Your fascism?
Which I think it's from 1995.
In New York Review Books. Really good.
One listener, and gosh, her name got cut off from this. But she sent in, she is putting together a checkbox. She says, Trumpism bears at least 10 of the 14 characteristics of fascism. I think we're not quite there yet, but certainly
I think it's Laura.
Something to watch.
Laura, I think, is the emailer. That's her name.
We got a bunch of nice emails. Maybe we'll get to them today, but maybe we won't. We'll do our best. One thing I wanted to say while I was traveling, I used my texture app, had a lot less crap to be carrying around. I no longer get on the airplane and buy a bunch of magazines, which was a huge issue because when we got to the airport Saturday morning at 10:30, they canceled our flight at 10:31 because their co-pilot didn't show up. So we had to go from LaGuardia to Newark. We drove, which took us 4 hours. It was a huge nightmare.
Did you find out what the story was with the pilot?
No, but I keep calling them and tweeting at them and threatening to sue them.
I called it.
Well, the real point is that I wasn't carrying around a bunch of magazines. Why? Because I have texture on my phone and on my iPad. You have unlimited access to over 200 plus magazines. You all know the ones I like: Family Handyman, New Yorker, Wired. I got Sports Illustrated on there. I got Rolling Stone. I only read now. I'm down to like when I read Sports Illustrated. It's only stuff about the Patriots or the Red Sox or something like that. Maybe the Bruins and the Celts. But that's basically, I don't have time for the rest of it. But that's the beauty of it. I don't have to read the other articles because with texture, you can actually pick out and create almost your own magazine. It's gone beyond delivering just the magazine itself. They made it easy to find and enjoy the articles that you want to read, or in my case, that I want to read. And then it has daily recommendations, exclusive interactive features, videos, and more. Texture is searchable, so you can mark what you like, check out back issues, view bonus video content. They even curate articles and magazines just for you or for whomever you're giving texture to this year. Why on earth would you subscribe to just a couple magazines when you could have all of the ones on your smartphone or tablet all the time for way less? That's the thing. You can subscribe to, if you subscribe to just even a couple of magazines, Texture is going to be a great deal for you. Right now, Texture is offering my listeners a 14-day free trial when you go to texture.com/majority. That's 14 days to try Texture for free when you go to texture.com/majority. texture.com/majority. Check it out. I tried to stay away from the news as much as I could over the past week, because it is coming, it is going to come fast and furious. You know, I had conversations with people. We had a couple of people over. Oh, I got to show you guys what John Benjamin gave me for my birthday. It's a 3x4 painting of him, a semi-nude. But that's not.
I would prefer not to see that.
Well, it's pretty impressive. But we had a couple of people over for New Year's, and this one guy who I haven't seen, well, I see him maybe twice a year. He said to me, he said, you know, last year at this time, you said you thought that Trump could win the nomination and that he had maybe a 15 to 25% chance of winning. And I just thought, you're an idiot, Sam. And we were both pretty drunk by the time we started talking about it. It was sad. No, I didn't punch him. I mean, He certainly didn't vote for Trump. He just thought like, oh, there's no way. And then I think he obviously saw it over time. And I was like, well, you know, 20-25% chance is still not much of a chance. Although when it is, it is. Didn't follow much of the news, and I want to get to this congressional ethics situation. I want to get to the Republicans or what their first, I don't know, 50 days are going to look like, maybe less. And then the stuff about the jobs, the sort of the propaganda we're going to see. I mean, we're starting getting a notion of what is this is going to look like and where the pitfalls are going to be. But one thing I found encouraging was this protest. I tend not to watch that much football these days. I'm still upset about Bill Belichick sending a letter, frankly, to Donald Trump. So I'm very ambivalent about football. But this was pretty impressive.
You could like the Steelers. Be a Steelers fan.
No. That's not going to happen either. Sorry. With all respect. With all due respect. I'm not going to do that. I just may not
so
want
with all due respect being none.
Well.
Do you have respect for the Steelers?
No. To Kelly.
Why?
In her suggestion. No, I have no respect for the Steelers.
Okay, good.
Because that Roethlisberger guy, I'm sorry. I got issues with
mess.
Him, too. All right, but let me stay on point here. This week at the Vikings game against the Chicago Bears, this is sort of brilliant because I think some people didn't even realize this was a protest. And they thought it was part of, I don't know, of the stadium or whatnot. But the Vikings play in a stadium in Minneapolis called the U.S. Bank Stadium. And it turns out that U.S. Bank, it's not a bank I'm familiar with. It's probably a regional one. It's based in Minneapolis. Is supposedly a major investor in the Dakota Access Pipeline. And so two protesters, and maybe they were, helped by a third person. Two protesters climbed up the scaffolding in this stadium and dropped a banner. And, I mean, it's unbelievable. The banner is... It's quite large. And I guess this is footage from Unicorn Riot where the guys are walking up there and they dropped the banner and it was up there for most of the game. In fact, all of the game, I think. I don't know at what point they dropped it, but they dropped it at like, I don't know, in the first quarter. And they wouldn't come down until the press were there to meet them. The guys were arrested. But very, very cool. I guess a lot of people, it made a lot of, it just brought a lot of attention to it and to U.S. Bank's holdings. And, you know, we're going to have to see more of this. And the funny thing about the banner is it said U.S. Bank and it used their logo. And for the most part, it looked like a sort of a not a homemade banner. And so I think people just thought, oh, wow, that's interesting. You don't see that often at a football game, the football team taking a position on something like this. Good for them. Meanwhile, you got to eat in 2017. And the way that we've been doing it at my house, at least twice a week for... I don't know if it was for the entire year. It may have been because I think last year for Hanukkah, Benjamin gave me a trial run of Blue Apron. And the food is delicious. My kids like to join in. They'll usually like cut one thing up. And basically what they do is they send you all the ingredients. They send you the recipe. You get to keep the recipe. And then you get to delude yourself that one day we're going to have all these recipes. We could just go out and buy this stuff ourselves. You're not going to do it. Why? It's not worth it. But the seafood is sourced sustainably under standards developed in partnership with the Monterey Aquarium Seafood Watch. The beef is raised humanely. Chickens are free range. Pork is raised naturally. Regenerative farming practices are used for the produce. It can be delivered to 99% of the continental U.S. and 99.5% of food deserts. And because Blue Apron ships the exact amount of each ingredient required for a recipe, they are reducing food waste. We rarely have any food left over. It's always just a little bit, and a lot of it's a little bit more than I should probably eat. But it's been fantastic. Some of the meals available in January: seared pork chops with farro and cranberry chutney, spaghetti squash and marinara with mushrooms and garlic knots, spicy shrimp and Korean rice cakes with cabbage and furikake. I don't even know what that is, but it's great. You get to be introduced to a bunch of new foods. You can check out this week's menu and get your first three meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/majority. You're going to love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron, so don't wait. The way they do it is actually pretty amazing. They pack it in recyclable materials. You can get, I think, anywhere up to, I don't know, we get two a week, but you can get like three or four. And, you know, you basically have a week to prepare this stuff. It's great. That's blueapron.com/majority. Blue Apron, a better way to cook. And after you eat, you need to go out and hire somebody? I don't know. I've been talking about ZipRecruiter for quite some time. Now that it's up, basically we've even blown through the anniversary of Matt and Kelly working here. But are you hiring? Do you know where to post your job to find the best candidates? No. Of course you don't. How can you? Because the problem is all these sites are changing at any given point. One's the hot one, one's not the hot one. If you want to find the perfect hire, you need to post your job on all the top job sites, and now you can easily. ZipRecruiter has 9 million resumes you can search through on their database. You can add multiple people to your account. You can make it the most efficient for your team to find the best hire. I would never, ever provide that type of access around this office, but I'm just saying one could if you... ZipRecruiter.com, you could post your job to 100-plus job sites, including social media networks like Facebook and Twitter, all with a single click. It's also a search engine for finding and posting jobs. No juggling emails or calls to your office. ZipRecruiter has an easy-to-use interface. You quickly screen candidates, rate them, and hire the right person fast. Right now, my listeners can post jobs on ZipRecruiter for free by going to ZipRecruiter.com/majority. That's ZipRecruiter.com/majority. The best time to look for candidates for a job is when you do not need them, because you have the time to really figure out what it is, who it is you need to hire, particularly if you have a small business. Because you don't have, you know, 500 positions to fill and everybody's slotted with something very specific. Try it out now. ZipRecruiter.com/majority. Try it for free. ZipRecruiter.com/majority. All right, let's get into what's going on with the Congressional Office of Ethics, or the Office of Congressional Ethics. You'll recall back in 2008, the Democrats took both houses. They got into the House in 2006, largely because of ethics scandals that the House in no way was set up to handle. I'm talking about the Abramoff scandal. I'm talking about the Mark Foley scandal. And the problem is that the Congressional Ethics Committee, basically, they had created some type of truce where partisans were using it to attack each other, according to them. And so they basically said, like, well, let's just not do any congressional ethics. And that way, we can take care of the problem. And so in 2008, the Democrats created, and the way they create this, and the reason why there was a vote last night before there's even a new House, and why you don't need Democrats to vote for this, is that the Republicans last night, amongst their own caucus, voted to scrap the outside independent agency that the Democrats had set up. They vote on it to include it in the rules package, which then gets passed by the Republicans. And so basically what you had was this Office of Congressional Ethics. And it was an independent body that investigates bad behavior by members of Congress. It allowed other people to report them without it becoming a tit-for-tat situation. It obviously had the ability, if there was any law breaking, to tell police. But basically, it didn't judge and hand out punishment. It simply referred reports. It basically was an investigative body, and it referred reports to the House Ethics Committee. Sometimes what they did is they investigated things and said, this is not a valid claim. And now the Republicans have voted to get rid of it. Well, they're not getting rid of it. They're just not making it independent anymore. And they're not allowing it to provide, to send potential criminal matters to the police or provide any evaluation on it. It bars, they now have barred anonymous complaints. So if you're a staffer and you've been sexually assaulted by a congressperson, you can't do it anonymously. It prevents the release of materials to the public in the event that the ethics committee decides, like, hey, we don't need to pursue any of this. Now, here is, now supposedly, they have now backed down because of how bad this looked. And Ryan and McConnell, or I should say Ryan and his whip, McCarthy, or I should say the leader of the House now, he used to be the whip, want them to back out, but they haven't actually. Here is Representative Marsha Blackburn this morning claiming the gutting of this independent ethics watchdog was actually making it better.
What's your response to when they say, how does this drain the swamp?
What it will do is provide more transparency. Anytime you can provide more accountability and more transparency to any process that is in place, then you're going to take another step toward draining the swamp. And I am all for draining the swamp. Because I think that anyone who knows me knows that. Right. I've spent much of my career working on reducing the size, the scope, and the cost of the federal government.
Sure.
And in its place, putting accountability and transparency.
Sure. And so you understand, as a champion of transparency, why something, a vote that happens with only Republicans at night, behind closed doors, gives the impression of something sneaky happening.
Most people would say 5 o'clock in the afternoon is not at night, but you know, we could discuss that. It does start getting dark outside.
Well, you know,
but
behind,
I've
you
got
to
tell
point,
you,
right? Behind
well,
closed doors, not open for debate.
That's right.
It sounds
it is,
as though
and
maybe
the Democrats
something is being
have
hidden.
The Democrats have their meeting behind closed doors also, and on Wednesday when the president comes to talk to them about how to fight against the repeal of Obamacare, they're going to do that one behind closed doors. And, you know, it is the conferences meet together in a room, and that is where they have their conference meetings. And each conference does that, and it is bipartisan, and it is bicameral.
Okay.
Wait, what?
Do you feel comfortable?
Okay. All right. Wow. So there she is. Marsha Blackburn addressing this. It's more transparent and more accountable. Now, let me just give you, here's just a little tip for that journalist. The next question would be, how so? Right. Not, but you are behind closed doors. I mean, this is the problem, is that, you know, it's not going to be sufficient to have journalists do the interviewing if they don't know at all what they're talking about. That's why you go to this notion of behind closed doors, like, and that it's at night, like to the point where you're arguing about when the sun goes down and literally what's happening with the door. It doesn't matter if they did it behind closed doors or if the door was open, or maybe they had French doors, or maybe it's a sliding door. No, the issue is, how does this possibly make it more accountable or transparent? So supposedly, following this morning, and apparently Marsha Blackburn hadn't gotten the memo yet, Paul Ryan, they amended these rules. And it is no longer, supposedly the office will continue to operate independently. This is according to Paul Ryan's statement. But it will now be, instead of folded into the Ethics Committee, it's going to be overseen by the Ethics Committee. In other words, it will operate independently after we stack it with people who we know will not operate it independently.
That sounds like a much more Ryan sort of solution.
Yes.
It's a little more elegant.
Indeed. And here is one of the sort of the Trump/Republican dilemmas that I think we still have yet to figure out as to how to handle. So Trump this morning tweets out bad timing, essentially. With all that Congress has to work on, do they really have to make the weakening of the independent ethics watchdog, as unfair as it is, it may be, their number one act and priority? So here's Trump basically saying this shouldn't be the first thing that they do. Now, of course, it literally has to be, because they want to change the rules. And so it has to be. But the question here is, do you say that even Trump thought this was a mistake, and then run the risk of Paul Ryan just changing the verbiage and then Trump giving it his blessing? I mean, do you use Trump as a cudgel or as leverage? And this is a question that I don't know can be resolved at this point. I think it's too early. But this comes up in a piece that Dave Weigel wrote on the Republican agenda, because the Republicans have been planning for some time in a way that Democrats don't do. And Democrats don't, frankly, have the infrastructure, right? I mean, here's Paul Ryan earlier in December, in fact, December 7th, saying that Republicans have been preparing for unified government since 2015. I'd argue they've been doing it since before then. Grover Norquist was on record saying back in 2012 that the ideal president for a Republican, and he was talking about Mitt Romney, the ideal president was a Republican with enough working digits to handle a pen to sign the legislation that's already been prepared. That was Grover Norquist in 2012. Understand, hundreds of millions of dollars have gone into preparing this legislation. It's been built in things like the American Legislative Exchange Council through countless Koch brothers funded think tanks. I don't think that they expected this would be the moment, but they were prepared for it. And here's Paul Ryan very happily talking about how he was prepped for this.
The way I would start this is it's a great expression, and that is the dog chasing the bus. And it's like, yeah. God, I want to get there. I can't wait to get there. Finally catches the bus, and it's like, why was I chasing this bus? Do you know what the hell to do with this bus?
Oh, yeah. No, we spent all of 2016 getting ready for the possible opportunity of having unified government in 2017. The House went through the entire exercise, every committee working, every member of the House Republican Conference.
What were you smoking?
Working
there,
on,
no one thought that.
I know no one thought that, but Speaker? We wanted to be ready. So we've been working on our tax reform legislation for over a year. We've been working on our welfare reform legislation, on our health care legislation, on our regulatory agenda, on our energy policy. So it's not just talking points and pablum. Our committees, what I told our committees a year ago, our members, is assume we get the White House and Congress. And then come 2018, what do you want to have accomplished for the country to get this country back on the right track? What does that look like? Plan now. This is your plan. So for the next year, this is 2016, back in at the end of 2015, do everything you need to do to get ready to do that.
Now, I think there's a certain amount of pablum involved in just what he's saying. But what they probably also thought, and this is where things are going to get ugly for them, they were preparing this legislation to pass this legislation and have it vetoed by Hillary Clinton, in the same way they did this 50-some-odd times with the Affordable Care Act. In the same way when they ran through the how to repeal the Affordable Care Act in 2015 through reconciliation, because they knew it would get signed and vetoed, or I should say vetoed by Barack Obama. They were planning to do the same thing with Hillary Clinton over and over and over again. She's going to make her veto tax reform, make her veto repeal Obamacare, make her veto all these different things. So they have all these bills ready. And they're horrible bills. Like, they're going to run into this problem with Obamacare. We've talked about this. We'll talk about it more. But now they actually have caught that car. And the dog is going to smack their head right into it. And it's going to knock them unconscious. In the meantime, what it's also going to do, it's also going to destroy the car. I mean, they're going to do so much damage to our government and to our society, that unless you're the CEO of a major corporation, unless you are making hundreds of thousands of dollars a year so that you are eligible for the tax cuts that are coming your way, unless you are part of the 0.03% of the country who are going to be subject to the estate taxes, which are going to get abolished, probably, I would say, within the next 6 months. It's going to be a bit of a disaster for you.
Do you think that this, I mean, the damage is a given, but do you think that this is where the sort of the distinction between Senate and House starts to open up?
Just
in the sense, you know, because if you're a senator and you have to worry potentially about a statewide race, you don't think that there's a little bit more hesitation?
I think there's a little bit more
hesitation. Gut Obama. I mean, that's what I mean. I'm sure she was just sort of talking tough. But Pelosi said a couple weeks ago, she's like, I don't think they're going to do it, period. They're not going to repeal Obamacare. Now, that's obviously incredibly unlikely coming out of the House. But do you think in the Senate, I mean, even Mitch McConnell alone represents Kentucky.
It's possible.
Yeah,
it's possible. But, you know, I think one of the things that's becoming clearer and clearer, I mean, I don't know if people experienced this when they went home, but the number of people that I spoke to who were either who did not vote for Trump or may have voted for Trump.
How many people like that did you run into?
Well,
the may have.
In Michigan, quite a few.
But they didn't explicitly say it.
No.
They're like, maybe I went the other way on this.
No,
that sort of
there
thing?
Was. Look, I'm in.
Did you ask?
I'm behind. I'm not going to say I'm behind him? Enemy lines. I'm
but
behind,
you're behind enemy
in-law lines.
Which is behind enemy lines.
So I'm not going to, you know, like I wait for people to come to me, right? Like I'm not going out and sort of pressing.
I think Sam's like in the corner stuffing his face with pie and then someone hobbles over. He's like, hey, you know what? I'm drunk enough. I'm going to go pick a fight with Sam about politics.
That's just what I wait for.
Of course, that's what
I wait
for.
But it's
that's the highlight of your time.
It's usually more like, so Hanukkah. I had a couple of people came to me who were just like, this is, and I was surprised. Like, they were like, oh my God, this is horrible. And I'm like, oh, really? Oh, I'm glad to hear you say that. But then other people were like, well, the normal Republicans will rein him in. And I got this from people who did not vote for him.
That's
and I
disturbing.
Find that they tend to be older and male. And I'm like, are you like even remotely aware of what's going on now? They don't seem to understand. And I got grief about this before the election, that Donald Trump could be both a rubber stamp and a loose cannon. That's exactly what he is. He's going to rubber stamp all of it with the added sort of like bonus of, I could really fuck, you know, like our...
Yeah,
like,
watch this.
Things up.
You want me to sign a repeal of the entire social infrastructure of the country? No problem. Stop distracting me. I'm telling the leader of China that he looks like a fag.
Right, exactly. I mean, that's basically
same
what
time,
it comes down to.
Done.
And here is Donald Trump at his New Year's bash. Well, let me get to this in a minute. Let me go through some of what is Ed Weigel's thing here. And what's interesting about this in terms of this whole question about whether or not do you work with Trump on some things as a way of creating some type of cleave between Trump and the Republicans. You know, over the holidays, Trump said, I like Chuck Schumer more than some of the Republican leaders. Sure. And on one hand, yes, I'm sure he does. I know people are skeptical of Harry Reid, but I have always said that Harry Reid fought, I believe, as well as he could and very quietly. He was always the guy who had the knife under the table.
He's really underappreciated, and I think he was a main reason.
People are going to appreciate him a lot more.
Oh, well, people were making memes about Joe Biden. Biden was offering cuts in Medicare and Social Security that Harry Reid
was
destroyed.
Fighting constantly.
Yes.
Constantly undercutting Joe Biden's attempt to cut things, like particularly Social Security. And because Social Security played an important role in his life growing up.
Yeah.
In particular. I don't have that same faith in Chuck Schumer. And I don't frankly have
that
same faith.
I don't think Chuck Schumer's wife has that faith.
I don't have that same faith in Chuck Schumer, not just in terms of his politics, but in terms of like his smarts in fighting. Nevertheless, this question is going to remain. And I don't know if there is a single answer to it. Weigel makes the case, or at least reports on the case that's being made by the Democrats in some way. And in the way that the Republicans are approaching this, that in 2008, when the Obama administration came in and the Democrats took control of Congress in a way that was far greater. Remember, they had 59 sitting senators. They didn't get the 60th until August, I think it was, or June, when Franken was sat. And then they only had it for another 5 or 6 months before Kennedy died. But they still had much more control. And I will note also, there was a filibuster at that time that the Democrats don't have access to now. Filibuster, which prevented confirmation hearings from going forward on judges and personnel. And what that did is you don't even have the administration in place. That prevented the Obama administration from just a practical standpoint from doing what they needed to do. But more importantly, they came in thinking that there could be some measure of bipartisan, you know, Obama ran on changing Washington. And so he genuinely believed that he could come in, maybe, I don't know what he genuinely believed, but they came in with this idea that we're going to have a bipartisan consensus. We're in a major, massive crisis with the economy. We all need to sign on to this and get together with the program. Yeah, not happening. Not only not happening, are you not going to get votes for any type of bailout or whatever it is that you want to do? Not because the Republicans thought they had a better plan. Give me a break. But we're not even going to let you staff up your administration. We're just going to keep filibustering all these people. Senate Republicans opposed. Okay, here he goes. This is what he writes. They spent, responding to the Great Recession, they spent the transition in the first month of 2009 on an $830 billion stimulus package. Remember, two-thirds of which were tax cuts.
Was it a third or two-thirds? I'll double-check.
With Obama aides openly hoping they could pass it with bipartisan supermajorities, every House Republican and all but three Senate Republicans opposed it. And within 20 days of the inauguration, the first Tea Party protests had broken out, sponsored by the Koch brothers. Republicans have preempted any problems like this by making no attempt to frame their agenda as bipartisan. And their voters don't need that framing. I guess it was one-third of which was tax cuts.
Still a hell of a lot.
Yep. So here is the benefit that Republicans have. A, there's no pretense that what they're doing is bipartisan. B, there's no filibuster for all of the things that they want to do in terms of staffing their administration. And C, they intend, at least for their big programs, to repeal Obamacare and to do tax reform through reconciliation. Quoting from the piece. This year's agenda from House and Senate Republicans has clarity that was often lacking from Trump's own campaign. Senate Republicans favor using budget reconciliation, in which measures can be passed with a simple 51-vote majority rather than the filibuster-proof 60 votes to tackle the ACA and undo much of the 2010 Dodd-Frank financial reform. Anything that involves government spending can be passed through reconciliation. Part of the undoing of the financial overhaul law, some Republican leaders have been planning strategies on how to effectively kill the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, whether by giving Congress control over its budget or finding cause to replace its director, Richard Cordray, with a weaker board. The reconciliation process is also likely to be used to pass tax changes, which both Trump and congressional Republicans want to use to lower rates and to end the estate tax. So you will get a more comprehensive tax cuts for the wealthy through the second reconciliation bill that they will pass. The first one will deal with the Affordable Care Act, and part of that is also a tax cut for wealthy people who are paying more on Medicare tax and on some capital gains taxes to fund the Affordable Care Act. Then they will go on and use the Congressional Review Act which allows Congress to cast simple majority votes of disapproval for regulations on any regulations that were passed following June of 2016. The Congressional Review Act, 21 years old, has only been used once, but Freedom Caucus has compiled a list of more than 200 regulations it views as vulnerable to a disapproval vote. And these things include, and this is from a separate piece, I think that Iglesias wrote, EPA's Obama-era regulations to cut carbon dioxide from power plants, trucks, and aircraft, as well as rules to reduce methane leaks. They want to scrap Energy Department energy efficiency rules on washing machines, air conditioners, and appliances. Cancel all U.S. contributions to international climate accords.
Of course.
Scraps Pentagon's mandate to pursue biofuels and other energy alternatives. Executive orders. And this is not all through the CRA, I should say. They're just going to ask Trump to reverse some executive orders about federal agencies reducing their greenhouse gas things. They want to get rid of the Healthy Hunger-Free Kids Act of 2010 and remove the new Nutrition Facts Panel requirements, which is scheduled to go into effect in July 2018. You know that this is just unbelievable. They want to get rid of the Healthy Hunger-Free Kids Act, which required the federal government to use recommendations from the Institute of Medicine to make the national school lunch program more nutritious.
This is like, what was, who wanted ketchup to be a vegetable, though? No, this is
that was
Republican
the
thing,
Reagan,
right?
The Reagan,
okay.
According to the Freedom Caucus, the regulations have proven to be burdensome and unworkable for schools to implement. As of December 2015, the USDA reported that 97% of U.S. schools were meeting the new nutrition requirements. And most parents support the effort. So in other words, too burdensome, 97% had done.
Well, I mean, it's at 3%. I mean, think about it. It's tough.
Yeah. It's that last 3%. The big thing that they're also going to do now, and this is going to have implications far beyond Donald Trump's regime, whether it's 4 or 8 years or 16 months. I don't know. It depends on when they, if there's impeachment. Is they're going to pass something called the RAINS Act. R-E-I-N-S Act. Regulations from the Executive in Needs of Scrutiny Act. What this means, and we've talked about this in the past, when Congress passes a bill, whether it's Dodd-Frank or clean air initiative, or whatever it is, they don't do the details of the regulations because they don't have the expertise on how to execute these things. So Congress passes Dodd-Frank, and this is one of the complaints of people, one of the complaints I had with Dodd-Frank, is that you pass this broad bill with broad goals and agendas. And then various agencies develop rules to meet these goals. And then in the case of Dodd-Frank, what happens is they meet with industry lawyers who say, we're going to sue you on this, 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 and this. You'll never be able to get it done. And until the filibuster for lower judge posts was repealed, Obama didn't have an ability to get people on the D.C. Circuit Court, which signed off on all these, which basically ruled on whether or not the SEC or the FDIC or whomever it was had the ability to execute these rules. Same with the EPA. So what this is saying is that any rule that is developed by an agency with an impact of greater than $100 million, which, understand, is nothing in terms of our annual budget and is nothing in terms of, like, industries, right? I mean, you've got drug industry, drug companies making billions of dollars of profit. So if you have a drug rule that affects four of these companies, the idea that it wouldn't be. So just give you a sense of how small that is. And this, again, was one of those things. It passed the House in 2011. It passed the House in 2013. It passed the House in 2015. Didn't necessarily pass the Senate. But obviously, in many of those instances, it was just not. It was just vetoed. So it basically says that every rule that has an impact of greater than $100 million must be put up for a vote in front of Congress. It would have prevented nearly every climate or employment rule change of the Obama years. Every single one. On top of this, it would also impact. There's a provision in the RAINS Act, Section 805C, that even if Congress takes a vote on it, because they're not taking a vote on whether or not to make this a law, they're just making a vote to resolve that this rule is legitimate. Okay, so the rule is developed in the EPA. It must then go back to Congress for a resolution vote saying we sign off on it. But even if Congress signs off on it, so consider this scenario. 2020, lightning strikes, President Elizabeth Warren, a congressional House.
Jill Stein.
A congressional Senate. They pass a law. It's got to go back. They don't repeal RAINS Act for whatever reason. It goes back. EPA standards. Congress has a resolution. It goes into effect. That law still can be challenged for exceeding its statutory. So it doesn't in any way enhance regulation. It only undercuts it. It doesn't protect it from future challenges from bankers or whatnot. It only can undercut it. This is a really horrible, horrible act. On top of that, Republican lawmakers also want to pass a law that would stop courts from deferring to federal agencies' interpretation of statutes. So in other words, what you're basically doing is you're making it almost impossible for these agencies, which staff up with experts in fields, to function. Not just, and we spoke to Sam Bagenstos about this before the break, by how you staff them, but also in terms of what they are statutorily allowed to do. So here's the question. Can Democrats obstruct in the way that Republicans can? Well, we know they don't have the filibuster, so they can't bog this administration down in their appointments. They can't prevent judges from sitting. They could vote against all of this stuff, I guess ostensibly to show differences, but they're taking the tack that when there is no difference between what Trump wants, presumably, and what, let's say, Democrats want, they should try and drive this cleave. Here's a quote from Murphy. Scott Murphy from Connecticut. I think I have it here. Chris Murphy, I should say. He says, I think there was a unique benefit to Republicans in obstructing the Obama agenda. In 2008, Obama's entire premise was built on fixing Washington by ending partisanship. It was dependent on getting two parties to work together. Mitch McConnell figured out quickly that he alone held the keys to success or lack of success. Democrats, said Murphy, would oppose Republicans when they can, but they're not in a position to block everything. Trump pays lip service to bringing people together, but his theme is that only he can fix it. That's about results, not whether Washington is working. So there's not the same political benefit to pure obstruction. Instead, Democrats see opportunities on issues in which Trump clashed with his party or where Republicans themselves worry that the party's position is unpopular. So I think the idea is that Murphy is betting that Trump's political fortunes are based upon his being able to carry out what he wants. Murphy's also betting, which I don't know if it's a great bet, that Trump actually cares about what he wants, as opposed to selling it away. But who knows? The fact of the matter is, maybe Trump gets a tweet saying, like, can't believe you're Paul Ryan's bitch on Medicare. And he just the next day is like, we're not cutting Medicare. We're expanding it.
That is honestly, that's the only move with regards to him, because I think so much of it is in some ways it's best in a certain way to ignore him to the extent that it's possible.
I agree,
but you just
don't
that,
know there.
That one pressure point, just like maybe there's a slight pressure point with House and Senate, is purely his vanity relative to, wait a second, you were strong and clear on Social Security and Medicare, and now you're becoming Paul Ryan's secondhand man. Like, that's not leadership. That's not strong. Paul Ryan's nothing compared to you.
Right. It's hard to know, but that's the tack the Democrats are taking right now. And the fact is, they don't have many ways to obstruct any of this. And if it's going to come down to policy, then you just let the policy dictate. And I think there's something to that. I think that's the way that Democrats run and organize around politics instead of the person, because it's not going to be enough to say this guy looks like a Cheeto and has hair plugs, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the difficulty, of course, comes in like when things turn authoritarian. And that is,
well, isn't that
this
also
is the
why,
dilemma that I've been talking about from the beginning, is that to perhaps defeat part of the Republican agenda might in some way
elevate,
enhance this guy's ability to become authoritarian.
Well, that's what some people say, that the sort of scenario needs to be, you need to sort of keep him below 50% at all costs because of the other scenario that you always mention. There's a terrorist attack. You need this guy to be universally disrespected and unpopular.
Very tricky.
You can only imagine what he'll attempt to do in that situation.
But that's where we're at, folks, and we're going to see more. And what's going to happen over the next days, weeks, months is just announcing this is what's going to happen today. And we're going to find more and more things too about, like, you're going to be hearing about, and I'm reading about this, like, I didn't know there was a provision in the Affordable Care Act that made it easier for coal miners and their families to get benefits for black lung disease. Now, maybe Mitch McConnell will put that back in, but if it, you know, it's reconciliation, I don't know. I don't know how you maintain that if you get rid of the taxes. I don't know. But we're looking at repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act, cut Medicaid, I believe privatize Medicare and Social Security, kill the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, repeal Dodd-Frank, privatize veterans care and tax cuts. I think that's just like, that's, you know,
that's the basics.
Yep. All right. Well, I guess we'll head
whole
into the
world
fun half.
Whole world's a laid waste. All right. Now let's go to the fun half. Sounds good.
The important thing is, you know, we got to walk and chew gum here. We got to figure out, and I think, like, You know, that's the thing. It's like, I don't think there should be a long-term plan. I think that there is, Bob Kuttner's wrote a piece about we should be pushing for impeachment. There should be an outside panel right now because there's going to be plenty of things. There's already things. Remember he said he would have no new business deals? He's already cutting business deals.
Well, I mean, define deal.
But it starts with the first thing that we're going to start with in terms of fighting Trump and the Republicans. And make no mistake about it, they are one and the same, plus the sort of like whipped cream topping of Donald Trump maybe an authoritarian. I mean, do not lose sight of, and this is important, when you talk to people about Donald Trump, you must pivot immediately to what the Republicans plan to do and his personnel, at least in short term. The pivot has to go to the cabinet nominees have no qualifications. They're just friends of Trump's, which is fine, but they have no qualifications and they're not providing the proper paperwork. They're not providing the, they're not being vetted.
FOTs.
And then you, and then you also can talk about, we don't know where Donald Trump's conflicts of interest are. This is a big problem. And then I think it is, in the short term, coming up with ways to cleave Trump from the Republicans. In the short term, anyways.
And then maybe that works. Maybe that actually does work both ways, though. Maybe that has a kind of mutually beneficial aspect, which is that the more you cleave him from the Republicans, then they become slightly more willing to think, why don't we just get rid of this guy and get Mike Pence in there? And then you get, well,
at least you have
the whole earth and a country is destroyed and America's poorer, sicker, and dumber, but at least you don't have, we're actually just going to turn this into an adjunct of Kazakhstan.
Right.
And, you know, my daughter is going to be president after me, and my private security forces are coming to the majority report.
Right. It makes it much, it makes it much simpler. But we shall see. All right, we're going to take a quick break. Folks, a reminder, this show exists because of your memberships. You can become a member at jointhemajorityreport.com. We get a lot of people bought gifts for the Majority Report. It's not just for Christmas or Hanukkah.
It's a surge. It's also for Ramadan, first and foremost.
Ramadan, of course. But it's also a great way of saying, hey, I hear, you know, we were talking. You were bummed about, you know, you're talking to your kids' friends, your kids' friends' parents. You're bummed about Trump. I just gifted you a month of the Majority Report. Or, you know, you talking to your father-in-law. The Republicans are going to rein him in. I just gifted you a month to the Majority Report.
Completely delusional scenario about how this is going to work. Just gifted you a month of the Majority Report.
You can do the gifting at majoritygift.com, majoritygift.com. Also, when you become a member, you have no ads. So if you're interested in the deals that we have, just look in the podcast description. We place them in there. But you're not subjected to listening to them when you're a member. I mean, I don't subject it. Some people like
it. We're not quite Bill Burr with it.
No.
Bill Burr makes his ads pretty entertaining. But those advertisers give him a lot of leeway. We would have to see if we could kind of get that sort of stretch.
Yeah. Oh. I haven't heard those. But
they're funny.
646-257-3920. We'll be back in just a moment. We'll take your IMs too.